Well, you always have to start with something heavy after lunch. So for that reason, Rust and Python. And I'm not going to tell much about myself because I simply have many slides about other stuff. And this will mostly be an example-driven presentation. So at the beginning, I will give a bit of motivation for all of this. And the only thing I would say about myself is that I work on natural language processing, and there we extensively use both Rust and Tensorflow. So that's sort of motivation for doing all of this. First I want to say a bit on what Rust is, because not everyone may be equally familiar with Rust. So Rust is a programming language, and you could say it focuses on a certain specific niche, which is, I would summarize as low-level programming. So it is a type-safe language, so that's parametric polymorphism, algebraic data types and all that, and it makes it very nice in modeling different kinds of problem domains such that bugs become compile time errors rather than runtime errors. It also focuses on memory safety, so it does give you very fine grained control over memory, but does it in such a way through a borrowing system that it's hard to get a use after free or a wild pointer or anything like that. So only if you use unsafe Rust, you typically can run into that kind of problems, but as long as you don't use the unsafe keyword, you're not going to encounter any memory errors. In contrast to, for example, C. And it also focuses on zero-cost abstraction. So there are a lot of abstractions in Rust, like iterators, but they're all set up in such a way that they cost almost nothing or nothing at all. So what we often do is, when we implement some code, we run a utility called cargoasm, and it gives you the machine code. And you often see, for example, if you have this long iterator chain with mappings and folding, etc., that it compiles to machine code that is just a simple assembly loop. So it succeeds pretty well at that. So in practice, the performance is comparable to C and C++. So you could see Rust, to summarize, as a language that works in sort of the same domains as C++ and C. However, it's a very safe language. So this is great for projects where you need to squeeze out that last bit of performance. And well, since you're probably also doing Python, Rust could be interesting in cases where Python is not fast enough and you want to implement a module in another language that's fast. You could do it in Rust. So traditionally, of course, people would be using C or Cython. But by doing it in Rust, you get a bit more safety. And in fact, two slots from now, we'll give a talk about word embeddings, and we'll also show a bit how you can build a Python module in Rust. Okay, so what is the problem that this talk tries to address? Well, it's born out of the relative, youngness, I guess, of Rust. So Rust 1.0 was only released 4 years ago, so it's almost 4 years old now. And of course, that means that the ecosystem is, well, I would say, healthy. So there are a lot of libraries, which we call crates. But since it's very young, there are obviously going to be sore spots where there is not a library that covers the functionality that you want. So it's not like Python, which has been around since the beginning of the 90s, where you have a library or a module for everything. And one particularly tricky area is machine learning. So there are not a lot of machine learning crates. And those that are there tend to be incomplete or sometimes not maintained after certain periods. So there are two or three machine learning libraries that provide the basics, but they haven't been maintained for 1 or 2 years. So that doesn't get you too far, especially not in a fast-moving field like machine learning. So the solution here is to use a non-native library, and such as Tensorflow, and use that from Rust. So you use what is available until the ecosystem builds up so far that we could actually completely run Rust. So Tensorflow, I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with Tensorflow, but you could see it as at an abstract level as a library to build computation graphs. So for example, you could even build a graph to sum two numbers or something like that. But of course, that's not how most people use it, because it also supports backpropagation, which allows you to optimize parameters in models. So the usual thing that people use Tensorflow for is for machine learning or deep learning. The core of Tensorflow is written in C++, and it uses kernels that are very performant. So it uses the Eigen C++ library for some kernels. But since a while ago, they also have support for a special version of MKL. And obviously, if you want to run on a GPU, it uses CUDA. It also has a very rich Python API. It's in fact so rich that some things are only defined in Python API and not in the underlying C++ library, which which makes life nice for Python programmers, but makes life more difficult for someone who doesn't do Python every day but wants to use TensorFlow. So for other languages, there is a very stable C API, and it hasn't changed since basically forever in terms of TensorFlow. But it primarily supports two important things. You can allocate tensors, so this is where you stash your data or your gold standard labels in, and it supports running sessions, so running graphs in a session. So it gives us enough rope to, it gives us enough rope to actually run a graph. So the good thing is that there is a really nice crate for Rust, which has been stable for a very long time. Actually, it's not 1.0 yet, but I've been using it for 2 years. And things rarely change, and it works very well. And it uses the C API. So we do inherit the same properties of the C API, namely that it is reliable, stable, but it doesn't change that much, but it also gives very limited options. So it's not so great for building graphs, and that's actually what we want to do if we make a new model, right? So the solution here is to take sort of a sidetrack and get the help of Python. So we use Python as a graph-building domain-specific language, build our graph in Python, and once we're done building a graph, we serialize it. TensorFlow uses protocol buffers, so serializing graphs is really easy. And then we load the Rust, the graph in Rust and use it from Rust. So if you define a graph in TensorFlow in Python and you want to use it in Rust, there are certain requirements to make it work. So the first thing is that if you use TensorFlow in Python, you may be used to just defining your graph and every op you do assign to a Python variable name. And you can just use the Python variable names then to, say, locate certain ops. But obviously, the Python syntax tree is not going to be serialized to Rust, so that's not available. So we have to be careful that we actually give names to ops that we want to address from Rust, so do proper naming. Usually when we start training a model, we first initialize all the variables using random initialization. So we need to provide an op to do this actual random initialization, otherwise we cannot really train from Rust. And we need ops to save and restore parameters, otherwise we could train a graph in Rust, but we couldn't save it, which would also be not so nice if your GPU just spent 20 hours on training a model. So we need to add ops for that as well to the graph. So these are things that are really required. Then there are some things that are nice to have. So when I just started out, I did this the most obvious way, and then I found out that I was running Python very often for basically every small change I wanted to make. So you can make the graph more flexible, and it's really recommended to do that. So one way of making a graph more flexible is to use dynamic batch sizes, because then if you change the batch size, you don't have to run Python again to build your graph and serialize it again. You can just give the graph any kind of batch size. The other thing is provide as many placeholders as you can for what you could call hyperparameters like the learning rate, etc. So that helps a lot because then you can also from Rust just set these hyperparameters. Obviously, this is not going to work for everything, so there are some hyperparameters which are really a property of the graph, like the number of neurons you have in a hidden layer. So those you cannot as easily control from the outside. So some things are fixed, and if you want to try really change the core of the graph, you have to go to Python to regenerate the graph. So I made a small example graph. This is a very simple graph for a model. So it's for a binary classifier. We could call it a binary neural classifier because it has one hidden layer. So the idea here is we take inputs that have two features. Again, this is a toy example. And possibly gold standard labels for training. We use one hidden layer, then we use a logistic regression layer, then we need an optimizer to optimize the variables in the graph. And I would call it a toy because it doesn't address, for example, regularization or anything like that. I just made an example that would fit almost on one slide and adding dropouts and, I don't know, L2 norms just took too much bit. So this is going to be fairly minimal. So this is how we would define the graph in Python. So this is our DSL, you could say. Like I mentioned, it's a good idea to define hyperparameters as a placeholder so that you can put particular values for those hyperparameters from Rust. So we'll create a placeholder here of a floating point, 32-bit floating point number. The shape is empty, which means that this is going to be a scalar. So just put in a number. Then we have two placeholders for the actual input to the graph. So input is the data that we either want to use during training or that we want to predict the class of during prediction. And well, usually those are floating point numbers as well. And here the shape is kind of interesting. So like I mentioned, we use inputs that have two features. So this is why sort of the deepest dimension of the shape is two. And the null is here because that's a way to communicate to TensorFlow that you want to use dynamic batch sizes. So if you were to put a specific number here, like 64, the graph would always assume that you have batches of size 64. Similarly, we want labels. So this is for training, so that we can communicate to the optimization, okay, this is the correct label that you should learn to predict. Well, I'm using int 32 here. You could argue that this should be booleans in the case of binary classification, but ints work as well. And shape here is non, again, because we want dynamic batch sizes. Okay, so then we've covered the inputs and we go to the actual network itself. So we have one hidden layer, and this dense op will just create an affine transformation. And the 20 here means that we get 20 outputs. So in old school neural networks, this used to be called a hidden layer with 20 neurons. I never really liked that phrasing, but anyway. And we apply the affine transformation to the inputs we got through the placeholder, and then we apply the nonlinear value function. Okay, so these are then, say, nonlinear projection of the input. And then the next thing that we want to do is turn these into probabilities for either of the two classes. And the way we'll do it is we will again do an affine transformation using just one output. And later on, we'll use the sigmoid to actually squash this value between 0 and 1, which is then a probability for class 1. So if the outcome is higher than 0.5, the prediction is class 1. And if the probability is lower than 0.5, the prediction is class 0. The reason why we don't apply the sigmoid here yet is because TensorFlow has this optimized loss computation, which does both the computes both the loss and applies the sigmoid in a way that's more numerically stable and I guess also more efficient. So you could say that these are sort of the unnormalized probabilities. So the next thing is to compute the losses. So for this, TensorFlow is a nice function. Sigmoid cross entropy with logits. These are our logits. And it will so implicitly compute the sigmoid function and then compute the cross entropy loss. And in order to do this, we give this function our gold standard labels that we got through a placeholder, and we cast this to a 32-bit floating point number because that's what the sigmoid cross entropy with logits wants, and we pass it the logits. So out of this, we actually get a tensor of losses, and we sum them up to get the loss as a scalar. And then we create an op for the optimizer and say, well, we want to optimize with the given learning rate, which also comes from a placeholder, and we want it to minimize our loss. So that's the basic training graph. Of course, I said, well, one thing you should do, you should always properly name your ops, which I didn't do here. So for that reason, this is the same graph, but now, whoops, where is it? So this is again the same graph, but to the relevant ops, I've now added a name argument where we specify the name of the op as a string. We will use this to address the ops from Rust. So you only really have to do this for ops that you actually want to make accessible from Rust. So for example, the hidden layer doesn't have a name because we typically don't want to get the values out of the hidden layer. Then there are some more useful ops. So we may actually want to use the graph to make predictions. So we need some op to do predictions. So this then applies the sigmoid to the logits and rounds them. So again, that the probability of 0.5 and higher gets class becomes class 1 and lower than 0.5 becomes class 0. And then we cast this to a 32-bit integer, so that's what gives us predictions. And computing and accuracy is also nice with this output compute accuracies for us. So one thing to be aware of is, if you're not familiar with TensorFlow, is that since it is a graph, it also models dependencies. So in the case that we actually are only interested in predictions, you might say, well, why do we actually have a placeholder where we give labels? Because the whole point of building a model is that we want it to predict labels, right? So luckily, because of the dependencies in the graph, TensorFlow can figure out that these are actually not needed, because to get a prediction, we need logits. To get the logits, we need the hidden layer. To get the hidden layer, we need the inputs. So nowhere in sort of this dependency chain, the labels come up. So if we're actually using this graph for prediction, this placeholder is not necessary at all. So it's only needed when we're doing training. Okay, so next thing to do is to actually write out a graph, and with that we need to add more ops, so one for saving and restoring graphs, and one for initializing graphs. So if you're familiar with TensorFlow, you've typed this probably a million times. So this is to create a session, and we bind it to the session variable name. And of course, due to this statement, once you go out of scope here, the session gets closed as well. So here we then use a variable scope to prefix the op names that we defined before with model. So in the end, the op name will then be, for example, model for slash predictions, just to give it a nice scope. Next, we create a variable initializer that we can call from Rust to initialize all the variables in the graph. And we create a saver. I actually don't remember why I didn't give it a name, but I think the reason is that it doesn't have a name argument. And even though it still gives a pretty nice name, which is very predictable, in contrast to some things related to it. Finally, we write the graph. So the graph that we actually built up is now part of the session object, so we can get it out of the session. And then we use the write graph function provided by TensorFlow to write out a graph definition. Here's where the, well, for me, the API gets wacky, because one argument is the directory, and the other argument is the family. Why don't you just do one argument for that? But anyway, it's like this, we have to live with it. And then we save it in binary protocol buffers format. Okay, so now we have a graph, and we've serialized it, and now we want to use it from Rust. So the procedure now is straightforward. So we first want to load the graph, obviously, that we serialized. So then when we have the graph from Rustland, it's just a graph, and it doesn't know what is in the graph and how we can use it. So the next thing to do is to actually locate the ops in the graph that we need to do what we want to do. And this is where the names that we attached to the ops earlier become important. So we'll use it to find the ops in the graph. And finally, once we have the graph, we can create a session object and then run sessions and train parameters or run sessions to do predictions. Okay, so first we'll load the graph. So I'll try to do some explanation of what is going on here for those of you who are not familiar with Rust, because the syntax may look a bit strange. So here the loading code is wrapped in a function, loadGraph. And well, the Rust fun starts with the first argument. So we're saying here that we have an object that we call graph-read. That's the name we bind it to. And this is going to be mutable. So the reason is that if we're reading out of something, it needs to be mutated, right? And in Rust, you need to indicate for data whether you want to use it mutably or immutably. It's one of the safety features of Rust. Then this graph read, so this says, well, this is the name of the actual instance, and followed by colon, and this is in the type. Well, R is a bit of a weird type. It turns out that, since Rust uses static typing, you always have to specify the type, but here, there's another thing going on. It uses generics, so a parametric polymorphism. So R is a generic type, and you can plug anything in there which implements the read interface. So this, well, I'm saying interface, but of course to Rust users this is a trait. And read is implemented by a lot of data types that can read. So for example, an open val or socket, etc. So that means that we could practically read our graph from anything as long as it implements this interface. So then I want to jump a bit to the end of the function, and that's because it explains what we were doing before. So at some point we'll create an instance of a graph, and this is a blank graph, and into that we import the serialized graph. So for this, we use the import graph definition function, and we provide it with the actual graph as serialized data. And this function or method expects the graph as a slice of bytes. So that means that we need to get this whole graph in one big byte array and pass that to this method. Well, of course, this is a bit of a weird API because it's the C API, and the C is probably a void pointer or something like that, or maybe a bar pointer. So for that reason, we need to read all the data. So we take our read, and we create the Rust equivalent to an array, which is called a vec. And well, it has to be immutable because we want to read data into the vec. And we read the whole read to the end. So if this is a val, we read to the val until the end of val. We read it into this array. Well, the other thing that we need for importing is the options for the importing. Well, we just take the standard options and pass that. So now we're almost done. So this is a bit of an interesting thing. So what it does is it takes the error, or the potential error that comes out of this import, and maps it to another error. And the reason is that the errors that are provided by the TensorFlow binding wraps a C data type, which is not cannot be sent between threads, and so it's not very nice. So I wrote this small function which converts it to a Rust string that can be passed around safely. So one final thing for the people that are in Rust. This is a data type that says we either return a graph for a successful reading, and if the graph could be imported, or we return an error. So this is a function that can return either of those two things. Okay, so now we have a graph, and we want to make the ops in the graph addressable from Rust. So for this, we again write a small wrapper, mostly for error handling. So this function takes a graph, the name of an op, and it returns either an operation, or if things failed, it will return an error. So we again use the graph object. So this ampersand here means actually reference, so we get a reference to a graph. And we get the actual operation by using the operation by name method, which we give them a string that contains the name. And if there's an error, we map this C kind of error to a Rust, nice Rust error. Okay, now we can use this function, so I won't spend too much time on this because it's very monotonic. But so we had, for example, an op called inputs. We used the name scope to scope everything as model. So now the name of this op has become model forward slash inputs. And then we use the add op function from the previous slide, give it the graph reference and the name. And out of that, we get the op. And that we do for all the ops that are relevant. And the same is true for the init and restore and save operations. I was going to rant a bit about this, but since there are time, well, there's not a lot of time left, I will not rant about this, so just skip it. The next thing then is to actually train a model. So now we have our graph in memory, and we want to use it to train a binary classification model. So before we start training, we have to initialize all the parameters that are in the graph, and we do this using the initializer. So here, a lot of things are happening. So first of all, this use is kind of like Python's import, so it brings data structures or functions into scope. And the first thing that we want to create now is a session, because the graph is always run in a session. So for this, we use the new constructor of the session data type. We give it a bunch of session options. Well, here we don't really care about the options. We just use whatever the defaults are. And we pass it the graph. So now we have a session, and in that session, we're going to run the initializer that is in the graph. So to do that, we have to pass arguments to the session run. So for this, there is a session run args object, which we construct. And then we say, well, your target for running this graph is the init. So this will have the effect of running the graph and specifically the op that is in it. Well, init doesn't really have visible dependencies, so this is kind of a boring case, but it does the work. So once we set it up, we can call the run method in session and give it the args that we've just constructed, and then usually it will run stuff. It actually never happened to me that it failed initializing parameters, but we're just handling the error in case it does happen. Okay, so then we will start training. First of all, we want to pass this hyperparameter for which we had a placeholder. And the thing is that if you pass stuff to the TensorFlow graph, you're going to do it through placeholders. But typically, these placeholders have to be tensors. So even if you have like a scalar, such as the learning rate, you first have to convert it into a tensor to actually pass it to the graph. So that's the first thing we're doing here. We're saying, well, please create me a tensor. And by the way, the shape is completely empty, which is the signal that this is a scalar. And then we're doing some kind of funny addressing to say, well, set the scalar to the learning rate. The fact that we do indexing here is that all the other types of tensors do actually have a shape, and indexing is meaningful. So to sort of stick to the same API, the binding also uses indexing for scalars, but you always use the index zero. I guess it is at least a uniform API. So then we again create our session run args object, but now we're going to do a bit more. So first of all, we add a target. So previously we called the initialization op, now we're calling the training op. However, calling the training op by itself would fail because it wouldn't know what to train on, right? Because it doesn't have any instances or gold standard labels. So these are also things that we're adding, and we do that using a feed. So this is called a feed. And we feed to the inputs op, we feed a tensor, which is the inputs tensor, which we presumably created in Rust by doing tensor new with the shape of the inputs and then putting values in there. Similarly, we add feed the labels to the graph, and we also feed the learning rate to the graph. Then we run the graph, everything works nicely, and then we've done one iteration of, a forward pass and a backwards pass doing back propagation. Since the time is limited, I will just skip this. So now we have done some training. Supposedly we have more data. We did a couple of epochs of training. And now we want to save the model. Otherwise, we let the model train, but we throw away the parameters, which is not nice. So for saving the model, we use the saving op. So this is done like this. So we say, well, the target is the save op. However, if we just say save, TensorFlow, of course, doesn't know what to save to. So we have to provide it with a path as well, which we do again through a placeholder. Well, the Python API was a bit weird in that we had to give the directory name and the file name separately. The actual graph is also a bit weird in that we can give it a file name, but it also always has to be prefixed by directory name. So even if you want that file from the current directory or save it in the current directory, you have to prefix it by some directory name. So that's why there is this prepare path that if there is no directory component, it will just add point forward slash to make it start with the directory component. Okay, so now we have saved the graph, so we're now in prediction. I will skip this again, since it's pretty much the same as saving. We now just run and restore up to load the variables back into the graph. Other than that, it's the same as saving. So for prediction, what we want to do is we want to get something out of the graph, namely the predictions up. And in order to get predictions, well, we have to input instances to predict the classes of, right? So again, we have a feed with our inputs, but now we're not providing labels because we're not doing training. And so now one additional thing happens. We actually have to get something out of the graph, which we didn't need to do earlier. And this is done using a fetch. So you do this by requesting a fetch of the op that you want to fetch. So here, the op with predictions. And this will return a token. And the token is something you keep in your pocket until the graph is done running. And then you give it back, and then it gives you the data that you want it to have. So next we run the graph, and then once it's done, we get out of predictions using the fetch method, giving the token that we obtained here. All right, so that's prediction. I realized due to time I skipped a few steps. I'm always slower than when I'm practicing. But if you want to look at this in more detail, we actually have a couple of full-fledged projects, including these two, that use TensorFlow from Rust using the techniques described before. So the first one is a neural sequence layer. You can use it to do part of speech tagging, entity recognition, and dependency parsing. And the second one is a neural dependency parser, which also uses a similar setup to run TensorFlow from Rust. Thank you. Excellent question. So that's right. Okay. So how do you explain this in 3 sentences? So let's go back a bit.
Maybe there's even a more full-fledged example here in this function.
Right. So here we return a result, which is an object that can either be success or it can be failure. It's either one of these two. The thing is that if you get a result and it's successful, you actually have to try out the successful value. And the thing is, if you want to do that, you would actually have a pretty big match statement. So it would match on, for example, here with question mark. So it would match on read to end. And you would say, well, if read to end is successful, then do this. If read to end is a failure, then do that. Often it's the case that you do something that can fail in a context where you can also fail overall. So you see that the function itself returns result as well. So the question mark is saying, well, if it's successful, then just give me the wrapped value. And if it's not successful, then immediately return from the function with this error. So here it's actually not that useful because here, well, here it will communicate the error if there's an error. But since read to end doesn't actually return anything, it might return a new size for how much it read. But we're not using it here. But in the case that we're actually using it, I think there was an example here, right? So then, if this is in the context of the function, if looking up and up fails, it will bubble up the error. If the lookup succeeds, it will unwrap it from the result, and it will then assign it to predicted up, for example. So it's error handling in one character. Very good question. So actually, we used to do it in Python before. We used to do it like this. We would get the data and prepare it in Rust. Then we would write it out to HDF5 format, load it up in Python, do the training there, save the graph plus all the parameters, and then load those again in Rust. Well, the reason we were using Rust is because the other code besides the model needs to be fast as well. But there were so many steps going back and forth between them. And here, I guess it's a bit the same. And the reason was mostly that once you're happy with the graph, you may want to run a training procedure with different hyperparameters, and then it's nice if you can just directly do it in Rust because you have all the other stuff in the project in Rust as well, so you can just access all the functionality that you've implemented in Rust, and otherwise you have to re-implement exactly the same functionality in Python as well. But yeah, previous versions were like that, so they would actually do the training in Python. So the next step would be, hopefully in the future, to do everything in Rust. Not because I don't like Python, but it's more if someone uses this software, it's a bit annoying that you have to switch back and forth between Rust utilities and Python utilities. Thanks a lot.